students, today we will be studying the oscillological features of the bony orbit. Now the orbits are two bony sockets which lodge the eyeballs and the associated structures. Each orbit is pyramidal in shape, having an anterior base or the orbital opening and a posterior apex. And along with this, there are four walls: the medial wall, the lateral wall, the roof, and the floor. The orbital opening or the base consists of four margins: supraorbital margin, the infraorbital margin, the medial margin, and the lateral margin. The supraorbital margin is formed by the frontal bone. The supraorbital notch or foramen is situated at the junction of the medial 1/3 and the lateral 2/3 of the supraorbital margin. The medial 1/3 of the margin is rounded while the lateral 2/3 is sharp. The supraorbital notch transmits the supraorbital nerve, supraorbital artery, and communicating vein between the angular and superior ophthalmic vein. The infraorbital margin is formed by the maxilla bone medially and the zygomatic bone laterally. The lateral orbital margin, it is formed by the frontal process of zygomatic bone below and the zygomatic process of the frontal bone above. The medial orbital margin, it is formed by the frontal bone above and by the lacrimal crest of the frontal process of maxilla bone below. The apex, it is the posterior end of the orbit, contributed to by the sphenoid bone. Usually the medial end of the superior orbital fissure is said to mark the apex of the bony orbit. We now go on to see the other four walls. The medial wall of the orbit, it is formed by the posterior part of the frontal process of the maxilla bone, the lacrimal bone, the orbital plate of the ethmoid bone, and posterior most by the body of the sphenoid bone. So four bones contributing to formation of the medial wall. Let us now see the lateral wall. The lateral wall is contributed to by the greater ring of the sphenoid bone posteriorly and by the orbital surface of the zygomatic bone and the medial aspect of the frontal process of the zygomatic bone on the anterior aspect. So two bones, zygoma and sphenoid, contributing to the lateral wall. The roof of the orbit is formed by the orbital plate of the frontal bone anteriorly and by the lesser wing of the sphenoid bone posteriorly. So two bones forming the roof, the frontal bone and the sphenoid bone. We then go on to see the floor of the orbit. The orbital surface of the maxilla forms the floor on the anterior aspect medially. The orbital surface of the zygomatic bone forms the anterolateral aspect of the floor, while posterior most, the orbital process of the palatine bone, this is an insignificant contribution near the posterior end at the junction of the medial wall and the floor. So three bones contributing to formation of the floor, and that is the maxilla, the zygoma and the palatine bone. Thus we have seen what bones constitute the formation of the bony orbit. Let us now quickly see what are the communications of the bony orbit. The orbit communicates through several passages with the adjacent regions. The orbital opening is through which the orbit communicates with the face. The infraorbital canal also communicates the orbit to the face. The optic canal through which it communicates with the middle cranial fossa. The superior orbital fissure through which it communicates with the middle cranial fossa. The infraorbital fissure through which medially it communicates with the pterygopalatine fossa, and laterally it communicates with the infratemporal fossa. The zygomaticoorbital foramen through which it communicates with the face and temporal fossa. Anterior and posterior ethmoidal canals through which it communicates with the anterior cranial fossa. And nasolacrimal canal through which it communicates with the nasal cavity. Thus, we have seen the structures or the bones which form the bony orbit and the communications of the orbit with the other neighboring structures. Now, let us see some more features of the bony orbit. The anterolateral part of the roof is slightly hollowed out to form the fossa for the lacrimal gland. The anteromedial part of the roof near the orbital opening is marked by a trochlear fovea or a spine for attachment of the fibrocartilaginous pulley meant for the tendon of the superior oblique muscle. The optic canal is present in the posterior end of the junction of the roof and the medial wall. The optic nerve and the ophthalmic artery pass through the optic canal. You can see it as a rounded opening there. The posterior part of the junction of the lateral wall and the floor is marked by the inferior orbital fissure. It transmits the maxillary nerve, the infraorbital vessels, zygomatic nerve, a branch from the inferior ophthalmic vein, and some twigs or orbital branches which come from the pterygopalatine ganglion. The boundaries of the inferior orbital fissure, superiorly it is bounded by the greater ring of sphenoid bone, inferiorly by the body of the maxilla and the pyramidal process of the palatine bone, and laterally by the zygomatic bone. The maxillary part of the floor of the orbit is marked by a groove that is called the infraorbital groove. It is seen in the posterior part of the floor. This groove is directed forwards and continues as the infraorbital canal in the anterior part of the floor and ultimately opens on the face as the infraorbital foramen. The infraorbital groove, canal, and the foramen are meant for the passage of the infraorbital nerve and vessels. In the anterior part of the medial wall, the posterior part of the frontal process of the maxilla bone, just behind the anterior lacrimal crest, and the anterior part of the lacrimal bone form a vertical fossa or a well-defined depression called the lacrimal fossa. This fossa continues down with the nasolacrimal canal. The fossa and the canal are meant for the lacrimal sac and the nasolacrimal duct respectively. The anterior lacrimal crest provides attachment to the lacrimal fascia, the medial palpable ligament, and the orbicularis oculi muscle, while the posterior lacrimal crest provides attachment to the lacrimal fascia and the lacrimal part of the orbicularis oculi muscle. We then go on to see the superior orbital fissure. It is located at the junction of the roof and the lateral wall. The shape is triangular with base directed medially and the apex lying laterally. This fissure connects the orbit with the middle cranial fossa. What are the boundaries of the superior orbital fissure? Medially, it is bounded by the body of sphenoid bone. The apex is formed by the frontal bone. Superior limit is formed by the lesser wing of sphenoid and inferior limit by the greater wing of sphenoid. Common annular tendon. The lower margin of the fissure presents a bony projection for the attachment of the common tendinous ring or the common annular tendon for attachment of the recti muscles of the eyeball. What are the structures passing through the superior orbital fissure? The common annular tendon divides the fissure into three compartments for passage of various structures. The lateral compartment gives passage to the lacrimal nerve, the frontal nerve, the trochlear nerve, the superior ophthalmic vein, meningeal branch of lacrimal artery, and orbital branch of the middle meningeal artery. The part within the tendinous ring is meant for passage of the upper and lower divisions of the oculomotor nerve, nasociliary nerve, and the abducens nerve, while the part below the tendinous ring is for the passage of the inferior ophthalmic vein and some sympathetic twigs. Thus, we have studied the entire bony orbit. We saw the orbital margin, the apex, the bones forming the roof, the floor, the medial wall, and the lateral wall. And then we went on to see the specific features that are seen within the bony orbit, the passages or the foramens and structures passing through them. Thank you.